as I said, the True Breakfast Show. We are driving you through the early mornings hours, give you the best in early morning radio presentation. Well, if you've been following our program, you'll be in to know that there seems to be, you know, similar trend. The day the task force were created, almost that same day, the criticism started. There are two main arguments that the critics have. Number one, they believe that the task force has many politicians than health technocrat. I'm using the word health technocrat. Also, they believe that the task force need to outsource some of the Ebola related services to NGOs. And when that happens, things will be on course. They are further predicting that if these actions are not taken, then we are sliding into deep failure. Well, to take all of the questions associated with the Ebola task force, we've called two persons from the office of the president and to give some answers. I hope that will work. However, one person is already here. That is a Press Secretary Jerolinmek, Piah. He's on time. We're still waiting for Mr. Gyude Moore, who will join us later on this interaction. My name is Mamadi. Stay tuned. Mr. Piah, good morning and welcome to the True Breakfast Show.
Good morning, Mamadi. It's again a good thing to be here.
How do you feel this morning? I see the usual pump in your voice. What happened?
Well, Mama D, if you just understand that as a nation we are in a serious crisis, then of course you agree that this is not a normal time for people to look the usual energetic ways, because people are dying and there is a need to be concerned, and we are all concerned. So of course there will be a little bit difference in our comportment, in our posture, and that's understandable.
Am I sensing any sort of frustration here?
Absolutely not.
I mean, even on the work of
But there are concerns, of course. You don't need to be frustrated, because frustration may be a factor that could maybe even get you off track. We are concerned. We want to remain on track, and therefore, no, we're not frustrated, but we're concerned and very anxious to see some kind of improvement in all that we are doing to try to contain the spread of this deadly virus.
Like I said, the criticism is getting a little bit higher, especially when it comes to the operation of the National Ebola Task Force, which your boss and our president chairs. If you meet her in the morning, early in the morning, with your usual briefing, what's the picture you sense in her look?
Was
she a little bit?
She will have a concerned look like I do, and like any serious man in Liberia
would
do.
For the criticism.
Well, Mama D, if we were following the quote-unquote criticisms, then you will hear us every day trying to respond to one after the other. We listen to them. In some cases, we think they are deliberately calculated to serve as a distraction. Mm-hmm. And because we want to remain focused, we usually we're not getting involved in running around and fighting the criticism battle, but rather remain focused, making sure that the kind of leadership that is required in this kind of situation is exercised, so that in the end we can talk when we should have done what is required to end it, because just moving into exchanges, criticisms, debates, and counter debates, we believe will not help the situation. That is why we've not been pushing ourselves in the middle of that kind of battle.
Okay, we have a duty to ask the question, and this is why we call you this
morning. And that is why we agreed to have come. We're here, and we'll do our best to address your concerns and questions.
Okay, let's talk about the task force. The prime argument on the task force is that it's composed of so-so politicians and lesser health technocrats, and that's a word I like to use. What do you have to say specifically when it comes to this criticism?
Well, let me start this way. Since the Ebola crisis began, the president, in our opinion, has given it her fullest attention.
Okay.
And has had a hands-on approach to it. She established what is referred to as the National Task Force, headed by herself, and until quite recently, in consultation with our international partners, reconfigured that structure.
Okay.
And so what the president sits over, what she presides over, is basically referred to now as a national consultative group. What that seeks to do and what that is doing.
Is that different from the national task force that was earlier set up?
Well, generally, when the president established the national task force, there was no structural explanation. A national task force was established, and then the task force began to meet. And as all of the actors started to come on board, all of our international friends and everyone, they advised that yes, you can still have a national structure that you refer to as a national task force, but with different compartments.
Okay.
So compartment one, which is still presided over by the president, is basically a national consultative group.
Okay.
It brings together all of our international partners, all diplomatic missions near this capital, political parties, representatives, civil society, whether you come from the press union or whatever, all these different spheres and sector of the society are part of that national consultative group. Still under that same arrangement, the task force beyond the national consultative group, you have the incident management system.
Okay.
And that's where you have all of the health practitioners in particular focused. And all of the international people that are playing different roles in directly being involved with containing the virus are all seated there. All of that incident management system is broken down into several compartments. You have prevention and health promotion as a component. You have treatment as a component. You have testing as a component. You have surveillance and contact tracing as a component. You have safe burial as a component and psychosocial support as a component. All within that one time, I mean, that one structure.
Okay.
And that is directly under the authority and supervision of the Ministry of Health. And they've designated Toba Yeswa, the Assistant Minister for Preventive Services, who hears that. So if you look and see Medicine Saint Frontier, for example, that is running a treatment center, they fall under this structure of the overall task force. They are part of the incident management unit. If you see the Center for Disease Control that is involved in all of the testing, they fall under this structure. If you find the Liberian National Red Cross that is charged with the responsibility of barrier activities, being ably supported by the Ministry of Internal Affairs, they are found under the structure. So beyond this, the National Consultative Group headed by the President and the Incident Management Unit, then you have the National Ebola Resource Center, coordinated by Mr. Dobojana, which deals with all of the resources, all of the logistics that are required to enhance all that is being done to contain the spread of the virus. So for example, the incident management system, if they needed resources or needed certain kinds of logistics to do X, Y, Z, it is channeled to the National Ebola Resource Center headed by Dobojala, and those provisions are accordingly made, and then the National Incident Management System that is directly involved in service provision, they are able to do their work. So this is what the structure is, and this is what has been working. So sometimes we get concerned when we hear someone saying that outsource. If Truth FM, for example,
no, we'll come to the outsourcing. We'll come to the outsourcing question.
Okay.
But
okay.
It seems to be, you know, the problem I've always had with the government is your ability to explain, to talk to the people. Now, as concise and clear as you have explained this, if you had done that 2-3 weeks ago, don't you think you have helped the system?
Well, but let me say,
I didn't even know that you have that this thing has been modified into
this,
something you call national consultative.
I'm not very sure that this has not been communicated. I'm not sure, but
That's what I know.
Right. If that's
because
not
no
been,
matter how you communicate in Liberia, if I have not heard it, okay. Then communication has
if
not,
that has
to
not
be.
Been. If that has not been communicated, then it's quite unfortunate. But I thought that has been done, and one of the reasons why you've not seen me, or you've not been seeing maybe Judy Moore, who is our program delivery.
I'm
coming.
Yeah.
It's because the structural arrangement that was put in place required that.
Initially.
No, I'm coming. It required that communication surrounding this entire Ebola business is not fragmented, that this person is speaking, that person is speaking. And so we tried to centralize it. One reason why you saw us coming was that it became a consensus. So many of the concerns were being targeted at the office of the president. And we had to then consult with the president that there was a need not to undo anything, but to simply complement what those who've been in charge of communicating have been doing. And so all that we've come to do here is to complement. And so if in your world you are saying what we've just communicated has not been out there, then well, it's good that we here complementing their effort to make sure that this information is out. But that's what it's been.
Okay, so the politicians are not quote-unquote plenty or social politicians?
No, it can be, because who's managing, and Jude will go more into that, because he's the project, he's a project man. So he's working in partnership with these people. Okay. Who managing the treatment center?
Okay.
Who's managing testing? Who's in charge of contact tracing and surveillance? Who's in charge of ensuring that people have psychosocial support? It's that politician. Yes, it is important to bring the politician on board, and that is why they all, plus others important actors, including our international partner, all find themselves on the national consultative body, which the president chaired. And this body meets once a month. When the body meets...
The one the president chairs?
Yeah, the consultative body meets once a month. And the reason why it meets once a month is so that it provides an opportunity for what is happening at the level of the incident management system, what is happening at the National Ebola Resource Center. They come and brief, not just the president, but the globe, because as I said, all of the foreign ambassadors, all of the foreign diplomats, civil society actors, they are all there
on that committee,
on that national consultative.
Okay, we'll come back to you to talk about that.
But let me make it clear that it does not disintegrate what was originally announced as a task force, except that the task force now was structured in such a way that different sectors and different components are focused on doing different things. If you look at the rear portion that has to do with fighting and making intervention in stopping the spread of virus, it's not politicians who
thank
are
you thank you. Those of you out there, we've been joined by Mr. Jerry Moore, and he's the president's project man, to talk about this whole wahala concerning controversies. My first question to Mr. Moore, what is your take? First of all, tell me who are working on this consultative committee, and what our partners are doing, because there is this criticism that the government should reduce its intervention, allow the foreigners, the foreign NGOs to participate.
Mani, thank you. And so it's good to see you.
Thank you.
It's good to be here again. I actually like coming to truth. I will respond to your question, but just quickly before, I just want to tag onto something Mr. Piah said. The way the whole our response is structured is that in terms of what's happening, how many people got sick, how many people got released, where we're opening a new treatment center, all the stats about the disease is put out by the Ministry of Health. The Minister Brown is the one who communicates on behalf of the government about the progress or lack thereof, whatever, on this disease.
Okay.
The Office of the President, however, the whole purpose for which the President sought power to lead this administration was to improve the lives of the Liberian people.
Hmm.
When you build roads, when you build hospitals, when you build electricity, those things are not ends in themselves. Nobody build roads because they don't want to look at the road. The intent of building the road is functional, is utilitarian. If I build the road, it will help improve the lives of my people. So Ebola goes to the heart of the whole purpose of the administration. It is killing the people whose lives we intended to improve when we sought power. And so the first and foremost thing we wanted to communicate this morning is that everything that can be done will and is being done to end this plague. No effort will be spared to ensure that the lives of Liberian people are spared, that Liberians do not continue to die under this plague. Now, I'll go to the question that you raised.
Also, sir.
The National Consultative Group, like Brother Piah said, is a cross-section of all of society. The Federation of Transport Union is on there. The Liberian Marketing Association is on there. Speaker Tyler co-chairs it with the president. There are members of the legislature on there. There are, like he said, you got his USAID, on the SRSG, the EU representative, all of our partners who in any way partner in the development of our country participate on this. And when they meet, like he said, the incident management team is able to brief them, bring them up to date on where we are in the fight. Then they go back to their own networks to be able to transmit that. But in terms of the day-to-day running, of course, the president gets briefing every day on the progress that has been made. But the National Consultative Group, there's no way this huge group of people I just described to have them come to the office every day for us to be able to meet with them. The incident management team, though, those are the people on the front line, the people who are directly working on this. And that includes, you know, Mr. David, his name is David, right?
Yeah,
Nabarro.
Yeah.
Was appointed by the Secretary General to as coordinator of all the United Nations agencies' response to what is happening on Ebola.
Mm-hmm.
Not just in Liberia, but in the region. And he came to Liberia along with, I think it was the second in command at the WHO.
Mm-hmm.
And they came to Liberia, they visited he was here for about 2 days, and the man from WHO was here for about a week. WHO then presented, after they left, they went to Guinea, they went to Sierra Leone, went back and presented a roadmap on how Ebola will be kicked out in the entire region. And that roadmap was released. It's a 27-page document, very detailed in terms of everything that needed to be done. Then in each country's plan was adapted to that general roadmap. For the last 2 weeks, 2 days ago, the WHO released another report saying that because of the exponential growth in cases in Liberia, unconventional means had to be used. For 2 weeks, they were here doing an investigative analysis of the outbreak. And what came out 2 days ago was a result of that.
So that thousands of people was with that.
That's correct. And I think a couple of things need to be they said thousands of new cases, thousands of people will get infected. If the people get infected and are brought into treatment early, they survive. My understanding is that yesterday, more people were sent home who were positive initially but have been cured and are now negative, and that today, even more people will be sent home who have become cured. Right, I don't know the exact numbers, but that's something that maybe Minister Brown or Toba Nyusua will be able to give us on. So the huge numbers of people will get sick if it continues to grow like this. If we take the appropriate actions, though, if we take adequate actions, those numbers do not have to rise to that. So the WHO has provided a strategic oversight of how the response to Ebola will be carried out. And the WHO remains engaged. If today, all day yesterday I spent on the field. If you go to my Facebook page, you see I put out some pictures. But if you go to Island Clinic, Jean-Pierre, the man there working, the engineer to design, because you see, because it's such an infectious disease, the way you design an Ebola treatment facility is different from the way you design a regular hospital in terms of the flow. Ebola treatment facilities are broken into red zone and green zone. Red zone, that's where the people with the disease are, and everybody going into the red zone has to be covered. Green zone, that's the safe place where doctors can change, where people, support staff can come and do the work that they need to do. Island Clinic was built as a regular hospital. It has been retrofitted to host Ebola. And so because of that, changes have to be made at Island Clinic. The people doing those changes are WHO. If you go to the Defense Ministry, unfinished Defense Ministry building. The whole place has been cleared. Another Ebola treatment unit is going to go over there. The people supervising our work, the people carrying out that work at WHO. Yesterday, we met with the International Health Partners. International Health Partners is a consortium of different groups of the Nordic countries. And what they do is they provide support to the WHO. Do you know why they're here?
Mm.
They are here to find housing for about 200 persons that will be brought in by the WHO to come and do it. That's the only reason. So all of yesterday morning, we're going around with them to be able to find a place to be able to do it. This thing, this disease, is beyond anything our government is capable of doing on its own.
Really?
There's no way this government on its own will be able to fight it. And I cannot find any government. Yeah,
so where is the argument coming from that government task force should relinquish some of the...
For me, it's been difficult for us to actually understand what it means. Mm-hmm. Like Brother Piah said from the beginning, treatment and isolation, the largest treatment facility in our country today, and eventually it will become the largest ever. It will go up to about 400 beds for Ebola patients. That's LY2. It's being run by MSF. The Ebola treatment unit in Foya is being run by MSF. Of course, they train Liberians who work along with them, but the people providing supervision and managing it, logistics and support, is MSF. MSF is also currently training other NGOs, like International Medical Corps,
Save the Children,
so that they too will begin to run other treatment facilities. If you go to GFK, you have Ugandan doctors there who are working under WHO to run the facility that we have there. So when people say turn it over to international partners, it's really, really difficult to understand what exactly are we supposed to turn over to international partners when the international partners themselves are already doing it. Almost 2 months ago, the government turned over the management of our lab, the one in Charlesville near the airport, to the CDC. And the CDC runs it along with NIH. And the CDC brought in their own lab that is at LY2. A few days ago, was this week or somewhere last week, the Italians brought in a mobile lab. The lab is in Foya. All of that stuff is being done by partners. Even if the Liberian government wanted to do these things on their own, we don't have the capacity, the resources, or the expertise to be able to do this ourselves. And we have invited all our partners to help us to be able to do this. So I think a part of the thing is turning over to international people. First of all, with the Ebola thing, a lot of people, people got sent home from work. You know, people are home. There's not a lot to do. And so some people just get out there and they want to say something. So it's difficult for me to come up with a reason why anybody looking at this. And the thing is, nobody has to explain it to you. When you go to EAW, you see the MSF flag there. You see the people working there, you know that MSF people. If you go close to the lab, you see the people that are working there. And what I did was I got pictures of the incident management team meeting all the people around.
Well, where is that though?
Ministry of Health, every morning,
who cheers
9 a.m., the incident manager, Toba Niswa. But on that team are all the responders, the international partners that are responding. This is an event happening in Liberia. The Liberian Ministry of Health has to be there as first host of these partners that are coming into the country. Two, regardless of the expertise that the people bring into the country, there is a certain national element that the country itself brings to it. If the people, when they say turn it over to international partners, do they mean that every single thing has to be turned? There are parts of this thing that we can never turn over to any international partner. And this is the core of what will end this disease. And that is behavioral change. You can build as many treatment units as possible, as many isolation centers as possible. If the Liberian people themselves in the communities do not take responsibility and begin to govern and change the way they behave towards sick people, towards dead people, you can have all the international partners. And that part about changing the behavior of our people, there is no way we can outsource that.
You are seeking the change of behaviors, but we continue to see people crying for help, you know, after the relatives have died in a particular house, to come and pick up these family members to go and quarantine them.
And that has to do with capacity.
Yeah.
Right? Pierre, you want to comment on that?
No, but the place I wanted to come in, you know, and it is important to get this clear. I'm sure when some people wake up in the morning and they hear that $200 million is being raised for Ebola in the region, when they wake up and hear the EU is giving €140 million, and all the different figures that have been announced, I mean, my take is some people get so confused and think that these monies have been turned over to the governments of the countries that have been affected. And so their cry, basically maybe to say, also this thing, is believing that you have this money, so you must turn it over to people who will do the job. And but like Judy said clearly, all of the direct practical...
So I'm coming, ask a straight question. And the question, I think I want to stress that question. Why is it taking you long?
I want to be very careful, right?
Mm-hmm.
The entire incident management system, and we were clear, we don't want to attempt that we know exactly what Toba Niswa and his group doing 100% begin to address question that he could better address.
Okay.
We've come purposely because, like I said, and you, like you said in your intro, one of the criticisms and all the different condemnations and all targeted...
But that's one of the major criticisms.
Well, and I'm sure Toba Niswa and others, because the Ministry of Information has a daily press briefing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure they've been seeking to address that as regularly as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And if there are thoughts that they have not addressed that adequately, I'm sure they stay available. Mm-hmm. And will be willing to give you.
Can somebody say the planning process has been very weak?
But no, and again, to be able to say that the planning process has been weak, I don't want to concede that point.
Do you want me to expand upon that?
No, because let me.
That's the same question.
Yeah, but I want to go to.
Ebola has always been open.
That's correct.
So we shall be in planning and to absorb the shock that was coming.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And I want to address that. I may not be able to address it in terms of the detail that say like Tawaniswa would, but it's to be able to accept number one, what time of the year is it in Liberia? It is the rainy season.
Mm-hmm.
LY3 has been trying to expand to 400 for a while now. The problem is to do any construction during the rainy season is very difficult. I went to LY3 when it was being expanded and to experience for myself the difficulty of building and sustaining an Ebola treatment facility. First, the Ebola treatment facility is broken, like I said, into these zones because the core thing that the people try to do when they run these facilities is to ensure that people who work there do not become infected working there. Now, 80% of the people who are coming have Ebola. But other 20% do not. When they come to an Ebola center, the purpose there is also to ensure if the man comes in with malaria, when he's leaving, he shouldn't leave with Ebola. To ensure that people coming to the center without the disease do not get the disease. So building an Ebola facility is a very technical process, is a very thorough process, and it requires expertise to be able to do it. That's the first thing. The second thing is that Ebola is a rare disease. What is happening in Liberia, Guinea, and Sierra Leone today is the largest ever outbreak of the disease and happening on the level of an epidemic. According to the Centers for Disease and Control, what is happening here in Monrovia is the first full epidemic of the disease. So the expertise on Ebola, responding to Ebola, setting up for Ebola is very limited. I mentioned to people the other day that the WHO itself, the unit at the WHO responsible for the whole globe, for all pandemics, that's MERS, that's SARS, that's Ebola, all global infectious diseases, pandemics, and epidemics, only 52 persons, and that includes the secretary and secretaries and support staff. So even the WHO itself was limited in terms of responding to that. Then Liberia, and you got to remember, this is also the first time that Ebola as a disease has appeared here in West Africa and that we had to deal with it. So, of course, it took us a while to be able to get a grasp of the disease and to respond. But the whole point of expanding ETUs and going to 1,000 beds, the whole point of going from 40 to 400 beds at Elwa, the whole point of trying to add more beds at what Dr. Brown is doing at Elwa too is intended to address that question. But like I said, the difficulty and because of the deadliness and the infectiousness of this disease requires a certain amount of time. When we went to Island Clinic along with the president, she met with the WHO engineer who was designing the place. She said to him, I want this place to be up and running as quickly as possible. I want it up and running. And he turned to her and said, Madam President, when we do this thing, we have to do it right so that the people who live around here are not endangered. Because of the quality of what they do and how well they do it, you know that people still live at ERWA. People carry on their regular lives at ERWA. It does not affect them. That is the kind of meticulousness that goes into planning, building, managing an Ebola treatment facility.
Do we still have the issue of logistics as a major challenge here? Because I heard the Minister of Health saying that.
Lack
of vehicles.
The Ministry of Health can more appropriately answer that question. I do know that the number of barrier teams have gone up now to 6. I do know that they have divided Monrovia into, I think it's 4 zones. Each of the zones has an ambulance, an investigative team, and has a barrier team that's assigned to that area. It appears now, from what we're looking at and from what after the WHO investigative report, that those 6 zones for Monrovia might be too small. The intent now is to expand the number of zones in Monrovia and replicate the same things in different zones and thereby reduce the response time for people who do call it.
Okay. But Solo, let me just also add that yes, all of these concerns that we're raising, limited vehicles, limited this, in real situation they must exist. I give you one example. when the two American doctors that were infected here were taken back to America, initially Ken Bremley was taken. Ken Bremley had a single patient, had a medical team of more than 10 persons catering to him to be able to recover. If we are to match that against the situation we have in this country, and what are the examples Jerry gave about just even the WHO department that is responsible for infectious diseases having just 50 persons in all. If you were to take that ratio of 10 persons catering to Ken Bremley and you brought it down here, and the MSS center at Elwha got 400 persons.
The weak health sector?
If you took 10 medical experts per person to treat each of the 400 persons, can you imagine how many individuals you have in a center to be catering to them? You don't have that.
So that comes to the same question of capacity.
Let me respond to Solos. The whole thing about having a weak health sector and somehow we're going to run back away from it. This is a health sector that is still trying to reduce the number in terms of maternal and infant mortality. This is a health sector that until quite recently was still establishing the basic health service program across the country. So yes, it is admirable. We've made tremendous gains between 2006 and now. But the system itself, is it where it ought to be? No. And you have to remember that this disease went to the heart of our health system. It was killing health service providers. If there was no other way to destroy our health system, then no better way to destroy our health system than that.
Even if they had any kind of capacity, that also eroded it, because if they had to pay attention to us, and that's what, to just add on my money, that's why yesterday, the president spent all day...
Come to the microphone.
Okay, the president spent all day yesterday visiting all of the existing health structures that have reopened their door to normal health services. Because we needed to also work on that as we try to contain Ebola. Because if you listen to the cases that come out, they tell you suspected cases, probable cases, all of that, meaning that there are several instances where absolutely you cannot say those individuals were dying from Ebola, right? Mm-hmm. Those kinds of cases will still have to be addressed by healthcare workers who, like Judy said, they didn't say were so high hit. We have a death toll been reflected on them. So as we try to reopen their doors and they've now resumed work, it was important for the president to reach out, not just to see them. Some of the things that they do need to run effectively have been provided by the government.
Okay.
So that they keep their doors open.
Okay.
And we're impressed by what we've seen so far. If you see for JFK, for example, mm-hmm. between August 1st up to where we are, over 400 live births, it means that gradually they return.
Yeah, return. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. To service. We here to ask the questions. The questions are many, but we'll take the most pressing and widely hit perception of the people. There was this thing about the $5 million. You want to comment on accountability in a whole Ebola operation?
I think they're going to release, if they haven't already released, release a report.
Does it demand as well?
The research center, because they disbursed the money. But I think the money was given to all of the responders. A big portion of it went to the Ministry of Health. I think something over $2 million went to the Ministry of Health, because the Ministry of Health had to respond and then they had to send it to county health teams. Then there was internal affairs. So all of the different... One of the things that we recognize from the very beginning, a part of it is we live in a country where there has been a history of corruption corruption. So people are always skeptical about the public sector and about its use of resources. And you know what? That is required for our democracy to work. But when we set up the Ebola Trust Fund, the president was very, very clear. If this trust fund is to be available for foreign partners to be able to deposit money in it to help us, then the rules of governing it, the governance of this trust fund, have to meet and exceed whatever requirements they too have.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what she did. When she hired Double Jala, it was because she believed that Double Jala would bring that level of professionalism
and
to
integrity,
that.
Yeah.
And so then Andrew Pope was seconded from the Ministry of Finance to be the controller over that account. And that money, the money used over there, was used according to this governance structure. And before that, The president also wrote to her chief of staff, Dr. McLean, to the GAC. And the GAC wrote back in terms of how they recommended that account should be run. And it was based on those rules. So in the first few weeks, it took them, they had to write the rules of how the funds were going to be governed before they could
begin. Based on the recommendation of the GAC.
That's correct. Before they could begin to disburse it. So it's going to be audited. And I have utmost confidence in how that money was expended, how it was used, it went directly to fight this disease. But like I said, they're going to release a report on.
And to just add on to that, Mamadi, all of us who are part of the governance structure, whether you're in the legislature, whether you're in the judiciary, whether you're in the executive, there was a clear-cut understanding and an agreement on what happens after the utilization of the funds. It was agreed that the Office of the President will make a report to the National Legislature. Mm. And we have to respect that because we cannot put a report out in the public without first making the formal to those to whom it was due. So when I hear some lawmakers, for example, Senator raising noise about a report, I wonder, because they should be aware that it was clearly the understanding that following the utilization of the money, there will be a report to the National Legislature and thereafter made public with absolutely nothing to hide. And so, to be jumping the gun while that process is ongoing, we see it as just the mere usual business of trying to politicize everything we do. But like I said, many of the things, like I said from the beginning, many of the things that have happened, basically we see them as attempt to distract, and we will not allow any distraction. Money is received, received will be accounted for, and we just have to be very clear. They're talking about 5 million. We're going to be accounting for around 5,600,000. And the reason is simple. Beyond what the government was able to receive as per the approval of the legislature, others were making donations into the trust fund.
And that will also be accounted
which
for.
Which came to around 600,000. And that has also been accounted for. And going forward, as fundings will be made available, whatever goes through the trust fund utilized will be accounted for the same way, subject, however, to the other procedures and processes of the GSC, as Judy said. So all of these agreements and understandings, they are just there. Lie down. People are aware of them. Rather than allowing this process to unveil the usual politics.
Okay, we'll come to that. And the Assistant Secretary General of the Liberty Party, Clark Tume, has just sent me a text message that he wants to disagree with some of the positions you just raised. So I'm going to give him the opportunity to state his disagreement, and of course you can respond. Clark Tume, good morning.
Good morning, Mamadi. Good morning to my brethren in studio. Thank you for the opportunity. Mm-hmm. First and foremost, may I say to the gentleman in studio that the apprehension of the general population on how the government is proceeding with this Ebola fight is quite understandable. You can recall that Ebola did not start in Liberia. It started in Guinea, and it took few months before Ebola entered Liberia. Now, if you look at the level of casualties that we have in Liberia, and you compare it to that of Guinea and Sierra Leone, it tells you that there's something wrong with the way we are proceeding with Ebola fight in Liberia. Last month, when Liberty Party had gone to the Red Cross to do a donation, the chairperson of the Red Cross was very clear that the government has ostracized them and they have not received a dime from the government in the fight against Ebola.
Say that again. The man from the Red Cross.
Yes, he said the government had not given them a dime. Okay. In fact, they were not totally involved. They were raising funds for individual and other institutional sources. That was not from government. And he said that resoundingly.
So that's a disagreement.
My disagreement is that there was so much misappropriation in the usage of that 5 million. I read a portion of the report that was provided by the information minister at one of his press conferences. The money was distributed among ministries and government agencies. And Mamadi, when Ebola outbreak in Liberia, our first priorities were isolation centers.
Okay, gentlemen, you made a very strong point. You want to state some of the misappropriation that you have? Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. Now, you can recall that when the money was distributed...
Does misappropriation mean corruption?
Yes, misappropriation is a form of corruption.
Okay, yeah, so go ahead.
If our priorities were ambulances, the compensation of nurses, the training and deployment of volunteers, and the purchasing of logistics, and you left those priorities instead of give money to, for example, Ministry of State that did not have any direct or maximum impact in the fight against Ebola is dropping. And you know that after the 5 million, after the 5 million was dispersed, we still have serious problems with ambulances. Mamadi, the reason why you called a spokesperson of the Sierra Leone government a couple of days ago was to also do something like a peer review to inform our own manner in which we are fighting here. But I don't know why you are not highlighting some of the points of stress. The mayor told you that they used 10 million and they trained 21,600 and deployed them across their country. Now, when Ebola became intensive
he said during the 3-day lockdown, there will be 21,000 people on the field testing people.
Yes.
And okay. He said they have expended little above 10 million and it's far beyond that. And all that came from the government of Sierra Leone. Through the money they have for development rules and other things. So they're diverting the money towards Ebola. So it was already in their account and the money was available.
We can copy from a pattern. It tells you that they gave every priority to the fight against Ebola and money will not be distributed among ministries. Let me tell you something where the government had a misstep again. When Ebola was sweeping Lofa and Monsoro County, the government was immediately trained volunteers and deployed the Guaji and other counties that were still free by them as a precautionary measure. Yesterday we received a report that 7 persons have died in Guaji and there's more isolation center in Guaji and most of the sub-eastern counties. So you can see that the prediction of the World Health Organization, even though we are afraid, we don't want it to come to pass, you can see that from all the signals and the writings on the wall, something terrible is going to happen.
Okay, Klatume, I have to give you an opportunity to send a speak to disagreement because everyone has the right to express their disagreement. So I'll give them the next 3 to 5 minutes to see whether we can have any response for Mr. Klatume.
Well, firstly, what I think I would say is that we've just announced that the report on the expenditure of the 5 million as agreed upon will be submitted.
Okay.
That report will also be subject to all of the other procedures of the GACM. In the absence of that, the Assistant Secretary General of a political party is already making claims and allegations of misappropriation.
Now he's quoting a Ministry of Information.
No, he said public.
He cannot say that Ministry of Information
The report given.
Analysis of the report and observe misappropriation.
Be careful, Solo. I'm saying this Assistant Secretary General of a political party is claiming misappropriation.
Yeah.
When we are on the verge of submitting the report to the National Legislature as was agreed. It has not been such.
Has Mr. Brown made any comment on expenditure?
It has not been such.
Oh, you don't know? Because he's quoting the Minister of Information.
It has not been subject to any audit process, but yet this Assistant Secretary General of a party has already made conclusive statement that there was misappropriation.
But is it reporting the public?
Solo. I wonder you were here. Were you sitting in the studio?
No, he's saying that the report.
And you want me to be dwelling on the years
of. No, Mr. P. My question is the report?
What did we say to you earlier?
That it's been prepared.
That it's been prepared. It's going to be submitted to the National Legislature.
He's saying that the amount was given to the Ministry of State according to his new analysis. He's quoting the Ministry of Information.
Okay, you wanted to comment on that?
Do we know that the Ministry of State
received anything? Gyude, go ahead.
A part of this sometimes is very difficult, heavy lies ahead. But I want to respond to some of the points that the fellow made. This is the problem in Liberia. This is the problem with our country. And in a country, for the democracy to work, everybody has to have an opportunity to have an opinion. But if everybody becomes an expert on everything, then it becomes difficult for you to be able to. This man is so painful. Guinea is fighting Ebola mainly in Gekedu, in that part of the country. Matter of fact, that's where it is occurring. Sierra Leone, mainly in Kenema, around Kenema.
Calahun district.
And for us, in Monserrato, beginning in Lofa first, but now mainly in Monserrato, in an urban setting, the numbers for Ebola, especially because of the way Ebola is spread, in an urban setting and in a rural setting, or in a smaller urban setting, will be completely different.
You don't have to be a rocket scientist to be able to know this one. It's basic. Number two, yesterday I listened to the BBC and they asked an epidemiologist working for MSF, why is it raging in Monrovia? And he said, we're still studying that. We're not particularly sure about it yet. And you have somebody from a political party. He's not an epidemiologist. He's not an epidemiological statistician. He knows absolutely.
Well, what different?
No, but here's my thing. He knows
what absolutely. What did Guinea do different to continue at a particular place in Sierra Leone? Up to now, Freetown is not being hit, I understand.
A part of this, Mamadi, is simply access.
What does that mean?
If I woke up this morning in Foya, and by nightfall I wanted to be at Firestone, that's possible. If I woke up in Foya and by nightfall I wanted to spend the night in Monrovia, that is possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so the more you open up your country for your people to move back and forth, the more you open up the country for the people to do business, huge trucks going to Guinea, people going to Guinea to do business, people living on the borders there and moving to. So in terms of the access, I don't know how easily accessible Conakry is for somebody who wakes up in the morning in Gegedu and decides he wants to go to Conakry. But a part of it is that Monrovia is easily accessible. This is a byproduct of, as you develop your country and make it more accessible for both people and services to move back and forth,
I don't know how strong that justification is. I'm not making access. You can start today, you still reach Conakry.
But here's my point. Mm-hmm. The point I'm trying to make is that an epidemiologist was asked,
okay,
professional. And he says, this is his job. This is what he does. He maps diseases. And he was asked why, and says, we are still studying this. We do not know why. And you have
something. It's a novelty, new thing.
So exactly. Okay. Let me just say one more thing. This thing where you have people with no expertise in a thing anyway coming to make all kinds of reckless statements about things is not right. Okay. Because
now, this what's is the person who is
MSF, MSF no, has told us before every to day question, they are rewriting their own rules, because when they built Ewa 3,
mm-hmm,
at 80 beds, it was the largest ever Ebola facility built. When they went to 160, they were in new territory. Everything about the disease now, at the scale they did with it, is new. You have somebody who knows absolutely nothing about this coming on here to make these reckless comments.
And you need to be very careful. Just on Friday, the president met with representatives of all political parties. The Liberty Party was in full attendance through its chairman.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to be careful with many of these young folks, because you recognize the assistant secretary general of the Liberty Party.
What wrong with that?
What, meaning that what he said is a position of the Liberty Party.
No, that one, just forget
about that. No, don't say forget about that. Don't say forget about that.
That is no issue to me. Whether he has expressed it and his title.
We're not interested in what is an issue to you.
Okay.
Yeah, if it's not an issue to you, it's an issue to me.
Okay, you take it as an issue. I don't. Okay, let me get Senator Sandra Johnson on. He's one of the persons who is in sharp disagreement when it comes to the expenditure. Good morning, Senator.
Well, in the first place, Mamadi, good morning, and I just want to make some clarification. We're talking about people making reckless statements. We have to be careful. All that I said, if they hire somebody, they got to help you. That is what I said. That as much as the government, all the people are helping us to fight this Ebola, the executive asked the legislature to approve, to make an approval of 20 million. Some of the 20 million was used. And all we said was, look, we have used 5 million. And it's our right to know how this 5 million was used. Nobody said. I did not say in my statement that people misappropriated money or people invested money. That we didn't say so. All we said was, bring a report.
That is clear. But I have one question. The question is fundamental. Are you in the know that the president had earlier stated that there will be a report?
I have not heard that. Nobody has made that report to
Senator
me.
No, the thing I'm saying, I hear you. I just want to ask you a question.
Okay,
so you did not.
Senator,
you had an opportunity. You made that point sufficient.
Okay, good.
If you are in the know, consciously in the know that the president will make a report, why are you jumping the gun? Why are you calling for the president?
Normally, that is not what you call jumping a gun.
Senator, in English, why I use that way? Jumping a gun means you rushing.
The report comes, but that was
Senator, you have to take time. I have to ask a question that might work. The question is, if you are in the know as a senator, a very responsible senator, why are you coming up jumping the gun? That's my word. You are jumping the gun, and I'm serious about that.
No, Mamadi, I'm not jumping the gun. That's your opinion. That's your thinking. Okay. I'm not
Let me tell you one of my other opinions. My opinion is that you're just making politics after out of this. That's my opinion.
Why?
Because, Senator, as a member of the national legislature, a national leader, you have the opportunity to get the information you want.
But Mr. Mamadi, we go on the floor. The issues are brought on the floor. The issue of asking somebody to make a report.
That is absolutely needless to say because I want to take you on. That is absolutely needless because you are already in the know. That is needless to say. You did not have to say that because you already in the know that the president will report. So why are you jumping the gun? I use the word jumping the gun. You started.
Why are you asking
after you know that the president will do the report, why are you asking the president to do the report?
Mamadi, that you cannot say that is political. I know and I said that it is important that the people come to the legislature as soon as possible.
That is needless to say. The president told you that she will report.
You cannot say that, Mamadi.
Senator, thank you very much. I think you did not get my question. You didn't answer the question. Because if you are in the know that the president will report, it doesn't make sense to me to say that the president should. That's already coming. How are those are my words? Okay, let's get interaction from our people, the people who...
And the point was, I think we need to be very clear with the senator.
Yeah.
At no point did anybody hear, when I said somebody making reckless statement, it was the person who called before, somebody from some platform.
Yeah, the party.
The second thing is, I think it's a disservice to the Liberian people and it's a waste of me and Pierre's time. It's not the best use of our time to come on a radio show and argue with a member of the government. Whether you're in a different branch of the government or not, if a senator wants the president, Mr. Johnson can get a meeting with the president anytime he wants, any day he wants. Not to come on the radio when we are on the radio of a senator in the sitting government to call us and kind of question us about something that is easily accessible to him, and he knows and admits that he's going to get the report. We're fighting an epidemic here, and still people joining.
Good morning.
It's properly, right to the emotional embodies, especially when people try.
And this is Asa Jackson from the Ministry of Information.
Jackson, let's get a little put down. Please go ahead and disagree.
You're accusing the ministry that they announced me yesterday.
Doing very well in this year, this morning. The first thing I'd like to do is to provide two clarification very quickly.
Here's
what has to do with the earlier statement made by Mamadi Diake to the effect that the issue of the National Consultative Group has not been communicated. Regrettably, that information has been communicated by the Minister Proper of the Information Culture. Mr. Brian, using the daily press briefing, communicated the issue of the National Consultative Group. Even after Minister Brian communicated at the national platform, I also re-emphasized it in an interview with Sumo, the TV cameraman, and even shown on 2FM TV. I was responding to the very well saying that we had school open and then video club. We had school closed and video club was not open. So in that interview with Sumo, I re-emphasized what Minister Brian said
for
the national consultation.
Have you released any report on the expenditure of $5 million?
Better and stay for my
so asking that question.
Listen to it. It has been communicated.
Yeah, thank you. The second one.
The second clarification I want to bring very quickly is, it is totally untrue. It is a deliberate attempt by the assistant secretary general of the Liberty Party to have accepted that Minister Brown gave breakdown of the report that Minister Brown does not even have. The report in question, what Minister Brown has continuously said, is that there will be a detailed and comprehensive report. Because it has been mandated by the president that everybody
people who are doing Ebola things or receiving Ebola money will do a comprehensive report, and even at that, it will be subject to the General Auditing Commission.
So the Liberty Party lie on the Ministry of Information?
Yes, sir. The Liberty
Party assistance general to a deliberate lie, a false lie, a colorless lie.
Okay.
Don't have that report, and as well, we never have communication.
I want to call it black lie, not colorless. It gets color,
Yeah, interesting, man.
That's a jacksy. Good morning, let me take this little call.
Colorless.
Good morning. Yeah, good morning, Salama.
Good morning, you're live.
Yeah, my word.
Yes, my name is Salai. My name is Donna Kwai from Flowerton. Good morning to you and people up here.
Good morning.
Thank you very much. You know, I listen to Brother Platumi. I mean, we need to listen to people sometimes. I think he makes some sense with respect to our priority regarding the $5 million. And I think it's an element that we think that way. But even this morning, I listened to the Minister of Health. He made mention of the constraint and challenges they face with respect to utility and vehicle. Now, if you have $5 million and these things are used to fight this Ebola, I think in terms of giving priority, priority should have been given to the because even when they can still complain that we have some logistic problem, we have some vehicle problem, and then you have used your $5 million in my right mind, that is a risk of preparation. And that's what he said, and I agree with him. There's not something we have to sugarcoat here. There's not something we have to tell somebody, people who can make reckless statements and the rest of it. This is all an error. And we need to be honest enough and fight this thing that we have this is called Ebola.
Okay.
So I agree with you, and I think we need to redirect our attention.
Okay.
And we need to redirect our
action.
Thank you,
Valai. We
are
out of time.
Mm-hmm.
You have a call?
No, I think we're out of time. So let's go back to them.
Just before the presidential press secretary, the voice piece of the presidency, before he closes, I would like to say this much. Why are we spending our time talking about a report that nobody has seen yet? How can you offer critique? This report is going to come out into the open. And again, I simply want to go back to the purpose for which we came here. We, working with the WHO, have asked about 60 governments and different NGOs for emergency response medical staff, doctors, nurses, and logistics.
When did you do that?
The WHO made that request a few weeks ago.
Okay.
And the government of Liberia, the president herself, has over the last week continued that. And even in places where the WHO has already made the request, the president follows up on the request to get as many international staff into this country to help to save our people. Every day, the numbers of people who are getting sick, the number of people who are dying, is very, very disheartening. Like I said from the beginning, the whole point of public service, the whole reason why we sought power in this administration, the whole point, every day I get to work with the president, this bothers her. And everything that can be done is being done so that we'll be able to end this plague. And I can say on behalf of the president that the people of this country have the president's word that she will bring this plague to an end. And that's what I want people to walk away with from here today. We are bringing this plague to an end. Everything that it would take, every resource it would take for us to be able to do it, will be brought to bear on this. Thank you.
Jerolinmek.
Yes, Mamadi, let me say this. When people seek to emphasize, be honest, let's be sincere, let's not sugarcoat, I'm sure some of those persons are still in safe zone. I who sit here, and all us in this government, we've lost dear ones. If this situation continues, there's no guarantee that we ourselves may not be infected, because we have to work, we have to interact with people, we have to. And so I said this to say, we as a government take this particular situation very seriously. And there's been no time that we've been joking. And there are people who think that we're joking. No, they got the guns wrong. Secondly, the people who are schooled in this situation, and we got to emphasize that, Medicine Center Frontier, for example, with all the different centers they run, whether in Foya, whether in Monrovia, whether in Guinea, whether in Sierra Leone, they've had not a single of their employee infected. Though they deal with huge population of people in quarantine center. That is because their protocols are straightforward.
Mm-hmm.
And all of these have been being applied in our situation. And so for someone to be insinuating that we are not serious, yes, we are serious, because some of us, there are people here who have not lost anyone. Some of us, we've lost, we have people who are close to us. And the potential for losing more people is there. And therefore, there's no need for joke here. The president, like Judith said, is reaching out. By September 10, the initial 40 of health professionals that are supposed to be deployed by the AU are to arrive in the country.
Okay.
So since now they're supposed to come, we're doing all that is necessary to make sure that we lay hands squarely on this. And to conclude, and I hope it lays this to rest, the issue about outsource, insource, and whatever does not have any basis, because the people you're thinking about, the people you're talking about, are the ones already who are handling the management of this situation. So except you say, we should now call the angels from heaven and allow them to do the job rather than MSF, WHO, and all of the people who are already doing the job. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Mr. Jerolinmek, Piah, Judy Moore. Thank you for your time with us on the Truth Breakfast Show. My name is Mamadi. We are going home. We're going to take a very short break. When we come back, we talk to our next guest. Before that, we'll bring you news and information from the world of sports. Stay tuned for the best of program from RCR.